So please familiarise yourself with the chat, the conversation function, and if you'd like to introduce yourself to the group, please do so in the chat. You might include your name, your organisation, and any specific interest that's relevant to this evening's webinar. As we go through the next hour, please also use this function to introduce questions or provide contact details or initiate a direct connection with another attendee. The Rural List was founded to connect rural veterans, specifically to address two identified gaps for British military veterans and resettling, transitioning personnel moving to the land-based sector. A lack of accessible information and a lack of accessible mentors. Since the launch event in February 2019, we've met every month, initially face-to-face and latterly online. We always host a speaker to throw some light on a particular career within the land-based sector, and it's particularly pleasing that more often than not, we're now able to find veterans of suitable calibre to fill that slot. Rural Link, my company, is happy to sponsor the F-Series, which sits very comfortably alongside our core mission of creating sustainable career pathways into the sector for career changers, primarily, but not exclusively, military veterans. We coach individuals, but are increasingly focused on developing bespoke education and training and generating strategic employment relationships with employers. This evening, together, we have an august attendance and a unique opportunity to make a significant leap forward. I'd like to particularly welcome General Sir John McColl, Chairman of COBSEO, the Confederation of Service Charities, General Sir Gary Coward, Chair of SSAFA, the Armed Forces Charity, and some other former senior colleagues. Hello, General Binns. Hello, Commodore Lower. And also Lieutenant Colonel retired, the Viscount Brookborough, whose generous support has enabled the DGS pilot on his estate. And also welcome to guests from the Republic of Ireland and the United States, as well as several chief executives of British charities. And a warm welcome, of course, to the resettling personnel and recent veterans who are seeking inspiration for their next career. I'm certain you're going to find that inspiration in the talk and in conversations and networks which will develop from connections you make this evening. I'm delighted, therefore, to introduce Sally Coulthard, MBE, to speak about the Defence Garden Scheme. Sally is in the final month of a 40-year Army career, which has spanned regular and reserve service. It is also a rather pleasing coincidence that despite having first met when she attended the launch event for the Rural List, she's also the mother of an officer who served in my battalion when I was commanding, emphasising, as if we need it, the close-knit, enduring bonds of service life. Sally began the project which became the Defence Garden Scheme a few years ago, inspired by an event she will describe. She published its first annual report in 2018, going on to develop a pilot at Brookhouse in Northern Ireland. She has also now completed a linked MSc and was also enabled to travel to gain an international perspective by winning a Churchill Fellowship. In 2019, she therefore visited various projects in the US and in Scandinavia, some of which are represented by you in this webinar. It is her Churchill Fellowship report, which was made available for you to read in advance this evening, and I know many of you have found it extremely informative. Sally, I really am delighted that you've agreed to provide this talk. I invite you now to take control of the screen. We are all attention. Thank you.
Fiona, have I managed to take control of the screen? Can you hear me?
You haven't yet. I can hear you. I can't see your slides.
Great. I think, am I there?
There we go. Coming in now. Perfect.
Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much, Fiona, both for inviting me to be the guest speaker this evening, but also most importantly for hosting this webinar, and particularly for coping so well just now with the technical challenges. So I hope we've got everybody, but it certainly looks like we've got the majority. I'm very conscious that we have a very diverse audience here this evening. As Fiona's already explained, it includes service leavers, academics, mental health professionals and practitioners, a number of fellow Churchill Fellows, and I noticed from the list an aspiring Churchill Fellow. clearly we've all got an interest in this subject, and I really do appreciate you taking the time to come to another webinar, which I think after 11 or maybe even 12 weeks of lockdown, you could quite reasonably have said you feel a bit webinared out. But with that diverse range, I'm very conscious of wanting to be able to have something that is of interest to everyone, and therefore you will appreciate that I won't go into a great deal of depth that in any particular area, but if there are areas, I'm happy to pick those up, not only directly, but you know, as we go on. So what I want to cover this evening, is the areas that you can see here this evening. As a Churchill Fellow, I was given a wonderful opportunity to travel to learn, but equally I'm mandated to return to inspire. So the first couple of slides I'll show you is what I believe the most inspirational project out of a number that I visited. And we'll just start with that to set the scene. And then for the service leavers in the audience, a short slide on my transition journey, really just to show that it has been a 3-year process. And a little bit about the Winston Churchill Fellowship, the Winston Churchill Memorial Trust, because this is an organisation I knew nothing about 2 years ago, and it really does provide fantastic opportunities. Some fellowship highlights, and then we'll sort of come down to earth, back to Northern Ireland, and spend about 10 minutes on the Defence Garden Scheme, where we've been working collaboratively with a number of partners for the last 18 months. At that point, I'll hand back to Fiona. She's got a very short, which should be about half an hour, she'll have a very short 1.5 minute link to some nature-based therapy, so we can just sort of change the pattern before she hosts the panel discussion. So, I'm sorry, I'm just getting getting requests from people on my screen, which isn't ideal, but I think I'll have to ignore them. So the first project that I'd like to talk about is the Green Road at Walter Reed Military Medical Center in Bethesda in Washington. And this slide really gives me an opportunity to just to focus us all in on why is this area horticultural therapy. I tend to talk about nature-based therapy just because there are obviously other parts of working with nature that are equally beneficial, although the Defence Garden Scheme focuses on gardening and horticulture. But if I'll just give you a second to read that, and I think it explains very clearly why for our community this is accessible, it's outdoors, it's physical, we work in groups, you can work individually, of course, if necessary, but that social aspect is important. And this book, Digging for Victory by Joanna Wise, which has just fallen off the screen, I'm sorry, but I can give you the details, is really a really good handbook for the work that we've developed to date. Why do I feel that the Green Road is so inspiring? Three reasons. Firstly, the vision. The vision is of Captain Fred Foote, who is a retired naval doctor in the US Navy. His whole philosophy, and that's from, you know, a full career of military experience and combat, working in hospitals, is that war is a wild place and we need a wild place to recover. He's particularly passionate about the fact that you need to recover and need a whole body, holistic approach, and that the way we should evaluate this is to look at both physical recovery and mental health symptoms, and the pioneering work they're doing on research I'll come back to a little bit later on. The second reason it's inspiring is the investment. You'll see this is a very significant project, and in a way that leads to my third point about why it's inspiring, and that really is because of the number of partners inside the wire, outside the wire, public, private, third sector, and so we'll come back to that when we've gone through the rest of the presentation. But partnering, I would say, underpins is the theme, and you'll see it in the fellowship report as a major theme that came out of all of the work that I've looked at as the best way forward for sustainable projects that engage a number of stakeholders, as I say, for a sustainable and enduring amount of time. So the Green Road project itself, you can see on the right. So it is a 1.6 mile long road, as you can see here. If you can see the detail, a 7 foot wide path that's been built and then has small areas that go off into the forest that then become sort of mulch paths and more secluded. So over on the right, it basically links two parts of a very, very large military campus. So over here on the right, we have accommodation for staff, for families that would be staying, and for staff at the university, staff within the hospital. And then over on this side of the road, you've within the campus, you've got a very large hospital, a very large university, and the rest of the military base. So it is very much a project that is designed for serving soldiers, for patients within the hospital, for staff, and for families. And I just really wanted to bring out an important design feature. So there's a number of these benches throughout the project. There's one here and then another one down here near the stream. A very simple piece of design, but within the bench, there is this drawer. Within the drawer, a waterproof journal and then a waterproof pen. And just, you know, when you're there, if you want to, you just write a reflection of how you're feeling or what the space means to you. So I was there the first week in October. Fred went off, I think, to fetch someone else, and I just sat there for about 20 minutes and read one of these journals. And it really is humbling and very moving about the thoughts of the people who've written there, what this place means to them and how important it is. To the point where I actually sort of said to Fred, now, come on, you've obviously written all of these and put them here specially just to show me how wonderful your project is, which of course he hadn't. So, as I say, a phenomenal project with real vision behind it and being used by all sorts of communities within the military community and the people that are supporting them. Just going back, as I say, because this is for service leavers predominantly this evening, my transition journey started 3 years ago when I came to my last tour, actually moving from the MOD to Army headquarters. And in good military style, perhaps, or I might have not have thought about it at the time, I went on a recce. I was interested in this area. I knew I had the benefit of a resettlement grant, so I could do some higher education, and I was looking at a number of different areas. But I was taken almost by coincidence in many ways to a project, an established project within Northern Ireland, in the north of Northern Ireland, called Blossoms. And the important thing about the visit to that horticultural therapy programme is that it was very evidence-based. They used the same NHS scales that we use in the Defence Garden Scheme. But it wasn't the 120 patients or clients that had been through that program, which were both veteran but also serving prison staff. So it was interesting to me that the prison service in Northern Ireland was sending employees who were suffering from work-based stress to the same program. It wasn't the statistics that showed that over an eight-week program, one session a week, the 76.7% of people showed a reduction in symptoms. The thing that struck me was the 5%, and of this, two or three were military, who felt worse. So I obviously picked up on this and delved into why they felt worse. They felt worse because they had had the time and the space and felt safe enough to come to terms with the fact that they needed more clinical support. And for me, that really was quite empowering because if that hadn't happened, then clearly we can all sort of imagine how much more difficult it would have been to move forward into recovery. So actually that significant number that had shown a reduction in symptoms, one could say was slightly longer. I clearly wanted to find out more about this area and to become, to learn more about it. And it was August. So I had a bit of a problem because it was either start this academic year or wait a year. So 5 weeks later, I was on the induction for the Masters at Coventry University. And I'm delighted that all of my, or hopefully they've all managed to log in, but my fellow students, so there were 8 of us who went on the journey of the 2-year part-time Masters in Social and Therapeutic Horticulture. Fiona's mentioned the concept paper that I wrote in July 18, which talks about the hubs and the spokes that we'll come back to. And then a series of, not really coincidences, but we then managed to have the wonderful opportunity to launch the work that you'll see at Colebrook Park, courtesy of Lord Brookborough. So we were developing our practice last year, and we've now run 5 or 6 of the 10-week programmes in Northern Ireland. And the opportunity of the Churchill Fellowship came up through the Masters. I wouldn't have known anything about it if that wasn't the case. And I would say that it was a combination of the Masters and the Fellowship, which meant we've been successful through the 3 gardens we work with in raising some grants of over £200,000, which means post-lockdown, we can move into a delivery phase for 2 years. And the final stage is that I'm on what I would recommend to anybody looking to work in the charity management sector, an excellent course this week, which ends tomorrow, but really is very comprehensive about all aspects of charity management. So I retire in July, and I hope, but I'm using this course to sort of sketch out the landscape, because it's not an easy decision, but probably to move into taking this forward through a community interest company. For those interested, or just to raise awareness of the Winston Churchill Memorial Trust and the opportunity to go on a travelling fellowship, I was made aware of it through, as I say, through a presentation we had on the Masters. There's a whole range of areas that you can apply for. It doesn't have to be mental health. If you look at the website, you'll see that. But I cannot recommend the support, the process, and the access, and if you look at other fellows' reports, really inspiring areas that people go off to travel for. So you're allowed to travel across 2 continents for 6 weeks. You put in an application, very much like a grant application to a charity, with you don't add any extra details. You fill in the form, you apply in September, get told if you've been selected for interview in the November, move through to January to an interview, told in the February if you've been awarded it, and then you're supported through planning your fellowship over that summer. So for me, that was last year. And then you return. You're not a Churchill Fellow until you've written a 15,000 word report. In my case, because I needed to write a master's dissertation, you'll have seen that the two are combined. So I'm obviously now in the post-fellowship support phase, which continues. So it's not a question of writing your report and that's it. So mine, I hope you will have seen, or for those that haven't, it can be forwarded, or you can find it through the Trust site. And I wanted to look at different service models. I'm very interested in how we can bring this therapy forward in a sustainable way, and try and move on from the excellent work that's done, but is sort of limited by grant funding and potentially stops and starts, which isn't as good for sort of providing continuous support for the people that need it. So that sort of is just a top level view of my transition and the Trust. And what I'd like to do now is just bring out some small but important highlights from the fellowship that probably aren't in the slightly more academic dissertation that's been published. And I want to do that in 3 ways. One, from a physician, obviously some participants, but also the practitioners that are working with the military across these sites. My first visit was on September the was in America. I'm sorry, my first visit was in Copenhagen, but my first visit in the States was the end of September last year to the New York Botanical Garden. Some of you may have seen I talk about a hub and a spoke model, and interestingly, in New York at the Botanical Garden, they hadn't called it that, but I met the chief exec there, and they have 300 small urban gardens across the Bronx that they support. They hadn't at that stage in September, but they were just starting to work on it, developed a hub, garden and the 10-week programme. So they were particularly interested to hear about what we were doing in New York. But they are partnering, they'd already started to partner before I got there, with the VA hospital in the Bronx. So I met the clinicians from the VA hospital, met the horticultural therapists that work within the botanical garden. The picture at the top is the Edible Academy, where traditionally they've been doing horticultural therapy with children and children with special needs. And from January of this year, although obviously it's been stopped with lockdown, they've started their first veterans programme, but very much based on sharing the work that we've been doing. And it was tying in with the way they were thinking about it. But Oliver Sacks, I'm sure most of you have heard of, a very famous neurologist, he used to take his patients and do his psychotherapy within the New York Botanical Garden. So that just overview from his perspective, that it's music and gardens that really are the most important, is obviously very helpful. The Chicago Botanic Garden was the next stop. This is where the theory of partnering has been published. Barbara Kresge has written, what for me was important, a paper that talks about, it's very important for the garden programme to stay within its swim lane, probably mixing the wrong metaphors here, but to do what it does best and partner with a mental health charity that has the case management and understands the individual and what they need for their recovery. Clearly the two need to work hand in hand, but that's what the Chicago Botanic Garden have been doing for many years with a number of veterans programmes. This one here is a workshop program. They partner with Thresholds, the largest mental health charity in Chicago, 10,000 people, of which there's a military division. And really, this quote here in green by Fernando Valles, who's a US Marine, when he said this to me in October, it's therapy without labels, and we don't do labels. I really did wonder why I have to write 15,000 word report, because it really does sum up why it's so relevant and works so well. And I'm delighted, and you'll meet later on the panel, Dr. Terry Horton from Northwestern University, who does the evaluations with Chicago, is with us this evening, and we hope to continue to collaborate in this area. Another design aspect, having spoken to you about the benches, this was something that struck me, and it was something that has influenced our practice in Northern Ireland, which we hadn't previously considered. These are two different examples of a shelter or a meeting place that the veterans have designed. One in a community garden in Portland in Oregon. I'm keen to make sure, you know, it's clear I didn't just go to very large, beautiful botanical gardens. I went to a lot of community gardens as well. But the point is made in both, really. So a place where the group can meet at the beginning of a session, equally they can close out at the end of a session. But most importantly, perhaps, in terms of practice, somewhere that if there is a personal conversation or a difficult conversation that arises out of the group and the therapist needs to just come away from the group with an individual, there's somewhere you can go that stays within the garden but allows that privacy. So, as I say, one in the States and then almost right of arc in terms of Danish design and Higgy. This is the Nicadia Garden, about half an hour north of Copenhagen. And this has been designed. This is where the Danish Army do their veterans programs with the University of Copenhagen. And they designed, I'm not sure if it was the Danish veterans or other groups that use the garden, but this is designed so that there are two benches, but the backs are at a slight angle so that you're not looking directly at each other, which was something that they specified. They wanted walls to provide some sort of feeling of security, but they didn't want them to be closed. And then they wanted the roof to move with the wind and not be solid. And so, you know, beautiful sailcloth and as I said, very beautifully Danish engineering. But this, it made us realise when I brought this back to Colebrook, that we have this beautiful space that you'll see, but that actually, because it was a market garden, there hadn't been a necessity for something like this. And so the veterans at Colebrook designed their own shelter. And again, just having that project as part of one of the programmes was very beneficial in itself. And then, so we talked about a physician's view of nature-based therapy. We've talked about the US Marines view of therapy without labels. This is a practitioner, Derek Stoll at the University of Tennessee, really picking up, which resonated with me because my first role as a junior officer was teaching soldiers their promotion exams, but that they really respond well to indirect learning. So the fact that our group are used to training, they are quite comfortable with a programmed approach, they're quite comfortable with a session that, you know, with objectives and objectives and outcomes within each session. And so that gives us an opportunity and the practitioners an opportunity, and it's obviously very straightforward in gardening, to use metaphors, which you just, everywhere you go, whether you're grounded or you're looking at the seasons or whether you're looking after seedlings and self-care. And Derek just said this was something that he hadn't expected and maybe doesn't happen if he's working with another group, like children with special needs or older patients. But with the military, he found that if he did talk indirectly about difficult areas or emotions and used metaphors from gardening, 2 or 3 weeks later, individuals would come back and would comment on how it had helped them reflect on their own circumstances. And this really was quite powerful. So I felt that's just a sort of symbiotic relationship, which meant he was investing more time in building the group, and the whole thing just works extremely well. And then really just coming back to a participant, which I think is important because we're increasingly keen to take a preventative approach and work with transitioning soldiers who've got a mental health diagnosis, and clearly will find transitioning even harder. That, you know, I'm not expecting every 25-year-old to know that he might like gardening, but this was quite powerful. Somebody said, you know, he probably was told to go on his programme. I think this was at Tennessee, but he said, actually, it was good because even if gardening's not your thing, this type of course over a number of weeks with a group and with support gives you time to work out what your thing is. So as I said at the beginning, I wanted to just focus a little bit more on this flagship project. So here are the partners, just to bring them to life. We've obviously got the naval base itself, a very large, I'm not sure if you can say this, it is very large, a sponsoring non-profit, but an established rather than very large, the Institute for Integrative Health, which does a lot of research and works in this area in Chicago, the philanthropic side with a foundation and perhaps the third sector, the design and construction, and then unconsciously we've got a number of academics in the audience, a really phenomenal research programme, which I think has taken Fred quite a number of years to put together, which is why I'll mention it. But these are the universities involved in what I do think is pioneering this holistic whole body approach, which will be looking at physical symptoms and mental health symptoms, heart rate and blood pressure, as well as the ones that we're looking at in Northern Ireland on anxiety and depression. I didn't visit all of these, but I did go down to the University of Arizona and I met Professor Esther Sternberg. And again, if anybody's interested in this area, I have got details or a couple of detailed slides. It is obviously the beginning of this work, but that's how they'll be using the Green Road, a number of different research projects, as well as support for patients in the hospital. So that brings us much closer to home and back to the work that you've heard a number of times and which I'm delighted to say almost everybody involved in Northern Ireland I think is with us this evening. So the Defence Garden Scheme, the concept that I wrote about in that concept paper 2 years ago, talks about a hub and a spoke model. And importantly, we have a sort of philosophy that it's all about people, place and purpose. I'll come back to those two themes as we go through. So the evidence base for this model, the model itself, rather than the actual intervention that we do, I describe in three ways. Firstly, at a strategic level, Dame Carol Black, who is a government advisor to Public Health England, but also to the Defence and National Rehabilitation Centre, she talks about community-based healthcare being delivered on a hub and spoke model.
So I picked that up, and we have our hub gardens, which deliver a veteran-only programme, and then still work in progress, because we did only start on the ground at the beginning of last year, but the development of spokes. And I see about 3 spokes within the radius of 1 hub, and they're mutually supporting, and we'll come onto that. The operating model I've already spoken about, based on the work at Chicago, and again, you'll see that in more detail as we look at the Colbert model. And then at the tactical level, the actual program that we've developed together and with feedback from the participants, but the principles of the model of the program that we run is based on the University of Copenhagen, which is really quite a clinical model, and has been running for a number of years, and importantly for this area, has conducted a randomized control trial with patients that had a cognitive behavior therapy program and a nature-based therapy program, and produced statistically the same results. So that was particularly why I wanted to go to visit Copenhagen, because that's very unusual at the moment in this field. But equally, because we are supporting transitioning and perhaps the more common mental health disorders like anxiety and depression, just as much as the more clinical end of the spectrum, the University of South Florida focuses very much on community reintegration, and making sure that when people, not necessarily are directly leaving this program, but as a result of all the support they're receiving, are able to move into roles within the community at whatever level is appropriate. And so we have a balance of therapeutic and vocational skills development based on, as I say, those two. So in a way, it's a hybrid of the two.
In Northern Ireland, we now have, and I'm delighted to say with the support of the Armed Forces Covenant Trust Fund, we now have 3 gardens that we will be able to, post-lockdown, move into delivering support both inside and outside the wire. Within 38 Brigade, we have a garden which we started to work with in November, and obviously has now rather stalled, but is ready to go as soon as we can. And that will provide horticulture therapy program, occupational therapy for serving soldiers that we hope will return to work, for transitioning soldiers, importantly for their families, and at the request of the brigade commander, particularly for families with children with special needs. And then those, particularly the transitioning soldiers, will be able to benefit from attending the programs that we run at the 2 community-based hubs. So up in the north of Northern Ireland, we have Ashes to Gold, an established mental health charity that is now running the DGS program. It joined us in the autumn, so they've run a couple of programs, and you'll hear a little bit more about that in a second. And then, as you've heard mentioned a number of times, we started the work at Brook House at Colbert Park in Inniskillen. So there's a sort of 1.5 hour radius for people to attend. So as you can see, this gives us, you know, 1.5 hour radius. People come on the bus, they come on the rain. The attendance is really strong, not just for our projects, but I would have to say for almost all nature-based therapy projects I visited. But this just means that we are managing to provide provision across the region.
So on the left, we've got the Inn Barracks Garden, and just a wonderful resource that we'll be able to develop for the programmes that I've described. And I'm very pleased that some of the veterans who've been down at Colebrook, who actually lived closer, they did travel quite a long way to come on the programme, but they're now volunteering here. So again, in a way, that's a variation of the hub and spoke model. You can move from a hub garden and then continue your interest, particularly if you haven't got a garden of your own, working in the other linked gardens within the scheme. Over on the right, a really fantastic resource at Ashes to Gold. This is a 10-acre site with a woodland walk, different orchards, and you can see beautiful polytunnels. But a particularly impressive social entrepreneur who runs this site, and there's an artisan bakery here, as well as a furniture restoration workshop. So again, for links to onward roots into the community, this garden, I think, is going to be particularly helpful for soldiers transitioning from 38th Brigade. Coming back to Colebrook Park, where we've now been working for over a year, and I'm delighted that on the panel this evening, so you can, those that are interested in particularly in the programme itself, we've got not only Dougal Dorman, who's the head gardener here at Colebrook, we've also got Dr. Catherine Kilfeder, who's the clinical lead at Brook House, where obviously, as I've mentioned, we're partnering, and Siobhan Nolan, who is the Defence Garden Scheme lead horticultural therapist and is a fellow colleague of mine from the Masters at Coventry, but has been working for many years in Dublin in this area in horticultural therapy. So I've talked a lot about partners. Our partners start at a regional level, so with the Northern Ireland Veterans Support Office, which coordinates veteran support across the region, and Liz Brown is with us on the panel and has absolutely helped us develop this regional approach as opposed to just in a single site. Colebrook Park is obviously our lead partner in terms of providing this phenomenal outdoor classroom. So for me, as a former educator, it just couldn't be better. And then Brook House, who are our mental health partner and who have their offices and facilities within Colebrook Park. So we're all co-located, or Colebrook Park and DGS and Brook House are co-located. We then work, or in predominantly Brook House works, but we all work together with Liz's support with combat stress, with BLESMA and the aftercare service in Northern Ireland to make sure that the referral processes are sound and the assessments work, and where at all possible we don't ask participants to have to go back over their history before they come on the scheme. And but most importantly, coming back to the Chicago point, the case management and the responsibility for the participants, although obviously we work very closely with them, is maintained by the referral partner. It's not as though they come on the scheme and there's no conversation before they finish. It's very much integrated, and we're developing and refining those processes and procedures all of the time. Our funding in 2019 was from Brook House, and I've mentioned already, so we now have a grant for each of those three sites. We will take them forward together over a two-year project after lockdown, which will take us through 12 interventions and 96 personnel, and we will obviously academically evaluate that work, and I very much hope that will be with King's College London. And the 10-week course we'll now have a look at, and I'll just let you read the details of that. And I think it's those last two bullets that I'd like to draw your attention to. I think if I'm really honest, my fellow students know from 3 years ago when I had to do my first mindfulness exercise on the horticultural therapy course, I was really sort of struggling to know why this was important. And I am personally now a convert, but I probably felt that our participants on the course would feel the same, and I was wrong. It is an area that in the feedback they give us, it's something that, again, like me, they probably hadn't been hadn't sort of experienced before, but that combination of the awareness, we call it awareness rather than mindfulness, and Siobhan can talk more about that, but those sessions are really important for helping individuals learn to self-manage some of their symptoms, and the supported reflection and the introduction to journaling is a very important part of the programme. The final point on that slide, I can't call it transition from the programme, because transition is clearly transitioning in our language from the army to civilian life. But the community reintegration planning, which we bring in was week 7, we brought it back to week 5. We have a Royal Marine, former Royal Marine, Sean, who's with us this evening. He joins the programme at this point. He may have met everybody in week 1, but he takes them through an individual workshop in week 5 to start talking about what would you like to do at the end of this programme? And that just makes sure everybody's looking ahead, and if there are areas, we can support them. And then when they go, when we're discussing the cases back with Brookhouse, we make sure that anybody's interest in volunteering or perhaps beekeeping or perhaps some further training is really picked up and is integrated into their progress from the end of the programme.
This is the programme the flyer that we use to make people aware of the programme at Colebrook. And I mentioned right at the beginning, we talk about people, place and purpose. And Dr. Alan Kellis, who's with us from the Royal College of Psychiatrists, is on the panel this evening. It was Alan that said to me, this is a sort of almost like a philosophy that underpins sound mental health recovery and restoration. And it really works for the Defence Garden Scheme, because we, in every hut garden, we know the people that are special, we know the community that we're working with is special, but equally the people supporting them, the horticultural therapists. We know the purpose is the same in each case. It's meaningful occupation, it's outdoors, it's in teams, and it's skills development. So those two areas are common to all hut gardens. You can see that clearly the places are different, but for different reasons, they're all special and provide different opportunities. Moving on to impact, we do this in four ways. We measure attendance. We use two national health scales to measure anxiety and depression. We follow through on the community reintegration programs I've mentioned. And obviously, we get the feedback from the participants. Just going through each of those without too much detail. I mentioned that attendance is very strong. That's not unique to us. But what I do think is very important about this type of intervention for our community, and I genuinely say and believe that we have 100% attendance. That doesn't mean eight people come every week for 10 weeks, which is almost 3 months. Clearly, there are planned absences. And clearly, at times, there are weeks when certain individuals don't come, because it's not right for them. But even in the most difficult of cases over the last year, and working with about 25 participants on the programmes, it's not been more than 24 or 48 hours before, because they've got contact with the group and the participant and the and Siobhan and Dougal, we're able to be in contact and see if they need more help. And obviously, if you're going to, I'm not trying to compete with a clinical intervention, but if you are just going to the doctors or to see a psychiatrist for a session and you don't turn up, it's more likely to be a letter, it's just slightly more formal. And so having that informal network that can support people and keep in contact with them is helpful. And then we use a generalised anxiety and depression score, GAD-7, and a patient health care questionnaire 9. This is just one example, but it just shows the measurements that we're taking, and a bit like the example I gave at Blossoms. They don't always move in this direction, but these are the averages moving from a moderately severe to a moderate as an average of the participants. I talked about community reintegration. We'd look at this in four ways in terms of outcomes. Social isolation. There's a case study of a very young soldier who had very severe depression and was very isolated. And we know a year later he's still in contact with two of the members of the Colebrook programme that he attended last spring. Volunteering, these opportunities are increasing all the time. And with Liz's help, we're building the links into the RBL industries and Greenman College, where there's a number of opportunities in the land-based sector. And then this is, Fiona mentioned her, this is my daughter, Katie. By complete coincidence, I'd had about 8 referrals wanting to go on to beekeeping. We were all discovering how important beekeeping is and how helpful it is with dealing with mental health symptoms, just as Katie sent me a photograph to say she was about to become a beekeeper. I'll let you read these points.
And then, Sally, I think we need to wind this up if we're going to have time for any of the questions, I'm afraid.
Yeah. We are there. So
So that is the point. We're now going to publish our manual and summarise and do the evaluation I've spoken about. We've got a number of sites which are here this evening that can talk about where we could establish over in England. And importantly, just to bring us up to date, we've been asked to look to see if we can adapt the model that we've got for health, frontline health and social care staff. And clearly, I've got to work on a funding strategy. So Fiona, I can now hand over to you.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Sally. A lot of ground covered there. What we were going to do is go for a short virtual walk, but I think we've run out of time to do that. So what we'll do is go straight into dealing with some of the questions that we have. We've got this rather splendid panel of people here with us, and which I am trying to put up, and most of whom have been introduced as Sally's gone through. So what I will do is just introduce the first question, which is from General Sir John McColl, who asked us in advance, what is the how can we encourage the DGS model to be rolled out across the sector? And if at the same time as dealing with that, we had a serving member of the REF who also commented, having been a recipient of horticultural therapy at Headley Court, I found it hugely beneficial. However, I had no idea of its existence before attending Headley. How would you spread the word across the military? And we just thought we'd ask Liz Brown, who is COBSEO's face in Northern Ireland, to just give us a regional perspective on how we roll this model out across the sector from her perspective. Thanks, Liz.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you for that introduction, Fiona. Can everyone hear me? My connection seems to be a little bit intermittent. Thumbs up from everyone, please.
Yes.
Yes, brilliant.
You can only just see the top of your head, though, just so you know.
I know. There you go. That's probably the best bit.
Is that there we go. Okay.
All right. Thank you, Fiona. Well, the first point I'd like to make is that the DGS pilot, which, as you've heard, has been rolling out here in Northern Ireland over the last 18 months or so, has been a fantastic addition to the increasing range of services provided for veterans here in Northern Ireland. It's been a success from the perspective of all involved, but most importantly, from my perspective, it's been really well received by the veterans who have participated and benefited from the programmes. And I think I have to say at this point that Sally's own personal commitment and enthusiasm have absolutely been key in all of this. And I, for one, would like to thank her for her vision in the Defence Garden Scheme concept. But to get down to the question, and in terms of a successful rollout from a regional perspective, I consider that the following five ingredients are fundamental, and you've heard all of them very aptly described by Sally in practice. The first, I'd say, is a sound concept, and there is no doubt that the hub and spoke concept works very well. I think it would work well in any geographical area, but it certainly works well here in the close and discreet and confined rural geography of Northern Ireland, and it gives excellent coverage. So the hub and spoke concept is excellent. The second key ingredient are excellent centres, and centres that have an enthusiasm and a passion for the cause, and of course the necessary real estate. I know that Colebrook is very well represented here this evening. That's our first key hub centre, and you've seen the pictures, absolutely excellent real estate and excellent passion from everyone involved in Colebrook. Thirdly, I think a regional point of contact is absolutely necessary. I'd like to think that the COBSEO-sponsored Veteran Support Office has played a part in providing that strategic regional knowledge and in facilitating and making introductions. Fourthly, a peripatetic Defence Garden Scheme coordinator. We've certainly had that very able facility, able to advise both hubs and spokes in the form of a very capable DGS volunteer, who's also done a lot of work in building wider relationships with colleges, employers, and other volunteering organisations, as you've heard from Sally, to fill that very important moving on or transitioning space. So that's been fantastic. We now intend here in Northern Ireland to reinforce and supplement that peripatetic coordinator with a new post, a Northern Ireland-based navigator post, who I can see staring at me from the screen here, a post funded by the Armed Forces Covenant Trust Fund through the Positive Pathways programme. So we will have that NI-based local knowledge on the ground. And finally, and the most recent addition to all of this is the DGS manual. It's a recent addition, as I say, but a really vital ingredient and a tremendous step forward in acting as a handrail for both new and existing centres. And what the handbook and the manual does is brings real consistency and fidelity to the purpose of DGS, but still allowing the very important individuality of people and place within the individual centres. So from my perspective, those are the five really key ingredients for a successful rollout regionally.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Liz. I am very conscious of the time. What I'm proposing to do is allow this to run an extra 10 minutes. But of course, if you need to drop off, I totally understand. It is now 7:30. What I'd like to do to just balance Liz's response is invite Andy Steele, who's on the call, who's running a project in Hull, and who's former Royal Navy himself. His example is live at the moment and might provide an instructive case study. And then I'll ask Sir John if he has any supplementary to that. Andy, are you able to flash yourself up and just provide any comments?
Thanks, on that? I think, first of all, just following from Liz's comments, one of the things that I think we really need to understand here is that in this sector, there's not a lot of collaboration between organisations, and we really do need to work together in this form to make this work from a rollout perspective. What can be done in pilots regionally is fantastic, but that collaboration to roll out nationally really needs to be in place. Since talking to you, Fiona, and the introduction to Sally, things have really progressed in the East Riding. Steve Kingdom's on the call from Hull Veterans, and talk about collaboration. This has gathered so much momentum and is very positive. The Humber NHS Teaching Foundation are fascinated by the Defence Garden Scheme. Humberside Fire and Rescue have also got 30 sites and would love to get involved. And I actually walked a site with Sean Allen on this week, actually, with a city council representative, an 11 hectare site that is fantastic, which really could be replicated. A couple of different things there, and I'm conscious of time, but what we're talking about as well in parallel is that pathway to employment. There are lots of different opportunities, not just horticulture, but in the arbor, woodland management, tree surgery sector. And whilst we can work from a mental health perspective, I think there's a definitive argument here to support a pathway to employment, especially in the north of England, where the government is talking about the Northern Forest and 50 million trees to be planted over the next 25 years. Those trees don't jump in the ground themselves. So it's great to see some of the names and faces here that Sally and Fiona have spoken about. And I think we're really embracing the Defence Garden Scheme and hope that we can see positive action in a very short space of time.
Thanks very much. So John, have you got anything else you wanted to add or comment before we move on?
Thank you. a great presentation, Sally, and great contributions from Liz and Andy. I think the points that I would make is that I'm looking at this from the point of view of where we are experiencing a declining funding climate for charities right across the board. That is particularly the case for service charities, as we lose a bit of profile as a consequence of not being involved in operations on two fronts, as we have been for the last decade. So against that background, we also have an increase in the requirement to deal with mental health problems, not just at the severe end of the spectrum, which is what everybody talks about, but actually right across the board. And the whole thing about DGS is that it deals with the complete armed forces community, both inside the wire, outside the wire, veterans and the serving and their families. So it, in that case, it is unique. It also has with it a bit of rigor, and people can understand why they're funding that kind of program. Now, if you're going to attract the contribution of the funders, Armed Forces Covenant Trust on a long-term basis, the MOD potentially, perhaps the NHS, then I absolutely agree the point that was being made earlier, that we have to have a concept which is fundamentally underpinned by clinical support and is recognised. Now, if you can do that, rather than have the sort of slightly piecemeal approaches we have to horticultural therapy and nature-based therapy, then I think you really do have a chance to access key funders on a long-term basis, rather than the hand-to-mouth existence which a lot of horticultural therapies has to go through at the moment. So I think that the first building block of that, I think, is to establish a process which has behind it a strong credentials of clinical and academic support. And if we do that, then we have the chance of going to key funders with a long-term bid, which really does give this whole DGS scheme some legs. So that would be my thoughts on it. And I just hope it does take wings, because I think it has an awful lot to offer for the complete armed forces community. Thank you.
Thanks very much. In the interest of time, I'm just going to move to one final question, which is from Dan Hestetler, which asked, he runs, he's executive director of Above and Beyond, which is a family recovery centre in Chicago. He writes, curious as to how many correlations to addictions are addressed in your research and initiatives, because he has many veterans that are afflicted, and any help would be appreciated. And I wonder if I could ask Siobhan, who has done some work in this area in Dublin, whether she'd be able to provide some insights on the correlation to addictions within the research and the work that's been going on. Thanks, Siobhan.
Thanks, Fiona. I'm not sure if you can hear me. Okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah. Perfect. Thank you. Yeah, thank you for the question there. Great presentation, Sally. I suppose just in relation to, first of all, I want to say in relation to the DGS, it's just been wonderful to be part of it, a privilege to work alongside Sally and up in Cobrook Estate there. But just to say that I do believe us, the DGS, can support an individual presenting with addiction, because we have a full, very much a multifaceted team. And Catherine, I know the clinical lead is there on site, and I'm conscious of the time. I don't know if you'll have an opportunity to maybe explain a bit more own experience in working in the field of addiction, where I work in a residential program, yes, in Dublin. Clients have embraced the use of nature-based therapy as an intervention. And maybe if I just use a story in relation to a particular client, and for the purpose of this, I'll give the client the name, a pseudonym of Joe. And Joe had came to the treatment centre, and he had never encountered nature. He had no experience whatsoever with nature. And as part of the treatment centre programme, he had to attend the 2-hour horticultural therapy sessions. And initially, Joe absolutely hated coming. He said he'd no interest in this. The only interest in nature was when he was outside, there was always darkness or he was strung out. And in fairness to Joe, over the couple of weeks, he started to embrace the horticultural therapy programme. He used to notice the colours. He began to get engaged in the activity. And he said to me that one particular time that he'd never, ever put his hands in the soil. He'd never grown a plant, and he was nervous of it. So I suppose what I discovered with Joe and other clients is that they're nervous of new experience. They become frightened, and also he struggles as well with, he spoke about the busyness of his head. So in using nature, he said that having this experience in being outside helped him calm down. His mind, and Sally mentioned the word groundedness as well. Using metaphors, he spoke about feeling connected and starting to feel connected with himself. Particular chap, he said he'd never planted anything, and one activity we got him to do was to plant up a container planter. And again, his nervousness was his choosing of colours, and he came with quite and created quite a beautiful display of colours. And over the course of the 14 weeks, he took ownership in it, and he spoke about this is in turn started to build on his self esteem.
Okay, I think we've lost Siobhan. Catherine Kilfeder, I think you might be able to, can you take up any of the reins on this subject?
So I can not talk about addictions specifically from a practical point of view, which Siobhan can, because she's clearly experienced in that. As a clinical psychologist and working with the Defence Garden Scheme, so my background is really about, you know, the evidence base, and with, I don't want to run the risk of sounding like a politician at the moment, but we are kind of driven by the science. We look for the evidence for what works. And in nature-based therapy, generally, there is quite a growing evidence base around the links between nature-based therapies and mental health and well-being, wider well-being in general. So a lot of evidence to show that it's beneficial. It improves mood, it improves thinking, attention, fatigue levels, you know, on standardized measures like the Warwick Edinburgh Mental Wellbeing Scale. It has demonstrable impact on that, which is an objective measure. In terms of addiction specifically, so there's kind of two sides to this. So in the mental health field, if somebody presents with a primary addiction issue, we're always taught that you must deal with the addiction first before you can deal with anything else. But there is some evidence around that people with primary addictions do also benefit from nature-based therapy. So it can help with things like reduction in craving. So if you can manage cravings, then in theory, those cravings don't subsequently lead into the behaviours of using the abusive substances. There's also some evidence that it improves, because a lot of nature-based therapies are done in groups of people. And people oftentimes with addictive type behaviours also have reductions in interpersonal skills. And so it benefits their interpersonal skills. And there's also some evidence that, you know, people who use substances are stimulating the reward centres in their brain. And there's a lot of evidence to show that being actively engaged in nature stimulates those same reward centres. So you're providing a substitute way of getting another kind of a high. So there is a lot of growing evidence around addiction specifically, but for me, it comes back to that combination of practitioner skills. So you need people who can do the practical stuff around the nature-based therapy. You need people with mental health training. And if you're dealing with people with addictions, I think you need people with specialist addiction training as well, like Siobhan, for instance, which is a shame we lost her. But and that kind of combination of skills with the right setting and the right program, I think, can be very effective.
Thanks very much. And sorry, Siobhan, I'm good to see you're back, but I'm afraid we are out of time. Those of you who want to stay on the call are very welcome to do so, but I will just wrap up for now. We've covered a very deep and wide range of subjects within this field of the example of the Defence Garden Scheme and the way it delivers nature-based therapy. And I think we've taken away that there is certainly a future for DGS, and everybody on this call has an interest in one way or the other of making that a reality. We've also understood very clearly from those who've spoken the need for a collaborative approach. And again, I would say that applies at the strategic level and right down on the ground at a local level to make this project and these projects work across the piece. And we're also very clear, all of us, I think, that the reason, one of the reasons why DGS is such a good model is that it is inclusive, but it is evidence-based. And with evidence, you can make a case that is compelling. And that is what Sally has been able to do. As the host of The Ruralist, I'm delighted that we've had such an intellectually stimulating evening. And thank you very much for all your participation. If you need to get off that, join us next month, where Stephen Kingham will talk about growing hemp in the Brecon Beacons, which is a rather nice juxtaposition to this. He's a serving officer who's set up his hemp growing business in ready for his departure. Thank you very much. Please do follow the Rural List on LinkedIn and Facebook to keep in touch with what we're doing. And please do share the existence of the group with your friends and colleagues who may find it of interest. Those of you who wish to stay, please do. Sally and I and any other members of the panel are here. There are other questions that were asked in advance that I will just read out so we can discuss around them. But for those of you who need to leave, thank you very much. A very good evening and best of luck in whatever you are getting up to in your lives. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, there's a few people dropping off. Sally, thank you very much. The other question that was asked, that I'll just sort of fill in whilst people are deciding whether they're leaving or not, was around the value of volunteering. Mary Smith, who's unfortunately had to leave, but did ask about volunteering, but it's got wider interest. I use volunteering, I'm starting to develop volunteering as a way of giving people experience as part of their resettlement journey, because obviously they can't take a second job whilst they're still serving. But what we're finding as well is that we can create volunteering jobs, volunteering opportunities which people understand, which might link to the hub and spoke model which Sally described. But we're also able to create enabling roles. So in Rural Link, I have a volunteer coordinator who enables all these roles. And that individual, of course, is getting benefit himself in building a role that goes into his CV. And if you're interested, there's a 10-minute video about the benefits to that individual on my the Rural Link YouTube channel. What the question was specifically about was whether there are other opportunities and can Rural Link volunteers be provided or sourced or invited to work on enabling functions with some of these charities, and the answer is probably yes. So there are executive roles as well as sort of labour-based roles that people are willing to volunteer for, because it gives them experience that they can then use when they're applying for paid roles later. Okay, does anyone else have a question they want to put to, or a point they want to make to what is still 33 people in this group? Let's see, did anybody put anything in the chat? Paula, stop shaking your head, I see you.
Did that make sense, Paula?
Yes, I will. Barry's asked, would he be able to know who attended? Yes, I'll put who attended on a list to make it available. I will not put contact details on that because I don't have people's permission to do that, but I'll put their organisation so you can know who attended.
Am I allowed to make a point?
Yes, and I was just reading that you have, Alan, put something in there, so yes.
No, well, I didn't. I'm saying, no, I'd just like to make a point that when you're dealing with veterans, that you must take into account their families. And because here in Northern Ireland, the veterans, a lot of their experiences involve whole families, but even where they don't, if you take a veteran away to do a course or whatever, one's got to be aware that the family, who may well be supportive, but he may well come back from a day's garden, or she, and may flop down in a chair and say, "Where's my dinner?" And the family tend to think that he's been on a day out in the garden, which is perfectly true. And I think that one wants to make sure the families completely understand what the veteran is doing on their day, and that it is a help, and that they've been working, because if you do not have the support of the families, you actually begin to create a secondary problem, which is the family and the veteran together.
Thanks very much, Emma Hayes asks, is there a process in place with DGS and Sally to have the opportunity to get guidance for concepts we may already have? Emma, have I got that right? Was there anything else you wanted to add?
Hi, Fiona. Yeah, that was really, really just some guidance on being able to perhaps roll out some of the concepts Sally was talking about in her presentation and how we could sort of get the ball rolling in regionally.
Absolutely. I'm very happy for Fiona to share my contact details and obviously we can. Where are you based?
Southwest.
Yes.
So I'm Exeter.
Yes, lovely, absolutely. So yes, no, more than happy to talk to you, and then I think probably better to do it, you know, one to one. Maybe hopefully next week, just because I'm on my calls tomorrow. That would be lovely. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thanks.
A couple of questions about the video. There will be a version of the video available, but I need to do an editing job on it, which will take me a couple of days, but to catch up with at least parts of it for those who had communication issues or if you want to forward it to someone else.
And just because I realised you wouldn't know, Emma, but I'm in Bath, so presumably not too far away. Well, I know you said Exeter, you said Southwest, and I'd forgotten the Exeter bit, but yes, I'm in Bath, so that makes life slightly easier.
Okay, I think that's all the questions that were in the chat. Alan Callis, are you still here? Did you want to add something I didn't ask you at the time on addictions or anything else indeed?
No, I think they were answered. Just to say that, besides individualised evaluations before and after, looking at the overall trajectories of people's lives and avoiding major obstacles and fallouts is also important. So addictions is an important thing to consider, and I know that the need to have joint working with experts both from mental health and addiction services wherever possible. I guess just to add my general, the reason why I'm here, I've got an interest in mental health services generally outside of the military veterans communities and how the specific programs are linked to civilian programs for health and well-being is an important thing to consider, particularly at the end of therapeutic programs, because there might be opportunities and skills that people have developed within those programs that will have very definite contributions to make to the broader community of nature-based interventions.
Yeah, thanks very much. Okay, I think I'm going to try and wrap it up again. For real. I'll give you a countdown unless anyone's got any other points. But I think we're there. Hang on. Birgitta says she's most interested to know if practitioners and clinicians gather and value assessing positive feedback way of individual programme participants' testimonials. What range of methodologies are engaged with throughout the therapeutic process? Between the practitioner, client, I don't even understand the question. Does anyone understands that? Can answer that.
Alan's nodding.
Yes, I think it is important. The simple thing to me is capturing personal stories that can be as important as any number of statistical and rate scales. And that can be in written form, but it can be in pictorial images or films. So, yeah, allow for participants to tell their own story. That's always important. And yes, there are some more specific methodologies around that in answer to Birgitta's question.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Interesting to know them. Mm.
Yeah, happy.
Thank you very much. Very comprehensive coverage of a lot of diverse material and practitioner questions and questions from the country at large, actually, with all the different programs you've got running. The gathering of information is very interesting because a lot of it doesn't happen where clinicians and the medical profession in the Republic tend to converse with therapeutic horticulture practitioners. That conversation doesn't seem to come together very often. So considering that we're looking for leverage within social and therapeutic horticulture being recognised as valid and its processes, it's great to hear the affirmation that clinicians are important to bring on board in the picture.
Well, that's a lovely way to end. Birgitte, and I may not understand you, but I assure you, I value you.
Aha. It's challenging medium of Zoom and such like. But there's a lot to be said, and it would be very good to have a physical forum for people to share how processes actually work, historically, because we've all advanced in organizations allowing a lot more freedoms for social therapeutic practitioners to bring in new methods and new ways of working with people and giving people more permission for individual participation. And as someone said there rightly, ownership over their own journey and choice making. It's very important, those freedoms. Yeah. Thank you very much for today.
No, that's great. We're very pleased you were able to join us.
Thank you.
Okay, I think it feels like time for a drink, if I'm quite honest. So thank you all again, and thanks for those of you, about half the group who were able to stay and just get the benefit of that very rich discussion going forward. As I say, this will be made available, so if there's pieces you missed or you know someone else who might be interested, give it a couple of days, and then if you look on YouTube or on the Rural Link website, you'll be able to find it. So thank you very much again. And I'm going to end this meeting with my big fat red button very soon.